speaker. That is Professor Erkan İstanbulluoğlu. He is a professor at the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering at the University of Washington. His research revolves around improving understanding and modeling interactions among hydrological, ecological, and geomorphological processes in watersheds. He's been a long lasting collaborator with like CSDMS and like being someone who's come to the meetings quite a bit, so many of you will know him. And he's one of the PIs on the LandLab project too, and sort of has been advocating for ecology and land use in the LandLab toolbox. Today he will talk to us about ecosystem processes and landscape evolution, specifically sticking with the theme of the meeting. Thank you, Erkan. The floor is yours.
Oh, thank you, Irina, for a great introduction. In this talk, I'm going to address this question of linking ecosystem and Earth surface models in three fundamental, to me, fundamental questions. And the first question is that how do climate and topography control ecosystems? And that is essentially, how can we reproduce the observed patterns of vegetation on topography, like the aspect patterns and with its corresponding different types of vegetations, the influence of flow convergence, flow control in rivers, and the elevation control. And these are done essentially predicted by distributed ecosystems and ecohydrology models in a fairly detailed way. There are some limitations of these models. For example, the disturbance feedbacks like fires and insects that needs to be improved. There are competition, establishment, mortality of vegetation dynamics has been limited. And there are computational scalability, but we kind of have the general structure and the capacity to be able to predict sort of the topographic and climate controls on the vegetation patterns. And the next question is that, how do climate and ecosystems regulate geomorphic processes so that we can essentially link an ecosystem process and ecosystem state variables with the state variables of the landscape, like elevation, soils, and rock properties, and so on. And the properties that fit into this category is that the hill slope processes like bioturbation that includes tree fall, pocket gopher mounts and borrowing animals and so on. There's landslides, there is the influence of vegetation on the flow properties and rain splash and sheet wash erosion. And there has been a lot of work that essentially to quantify these processes. And I'm gonna categorize them into four different categories. There were implicit formulations that use the geomorphic transport laws that are used in the landscape evolution models. There have been mechanistic formulations that essentially integrated a state variable in the ecosystem domain with a state variable in the geomorphology domain within the realm of diffusive processes. There has been great literature on that, and more recently. And there has been a lot of work in fluid mechanics, in ecohydraulics, to study water and vegetation interactions, flow and vegetation interactions. And there have been a lot of work in the mechanistic landslide models. But if you look at these different models, the first two is maybe long-term processes, and the second two are more like short-term processes and that relates to the shorter-term timescale. So one challenge is that how to link all of these in a landscape evolution model. The third question is what are the emerging outcomes, emerging patterns of a coupled ecogeomorphic system? And I will highlight a few patterns that I can think of. In one such pattern is that the influence of mean annual precipitation and vegetation growth on slope gradient. There seems to be an increase in slope as vegetation becomes, as biomass increases on the landscape. In this first study from Jeffrey et al. From the Central Andes. similar type of behavior is observed in New Mexico as well, in a lot of semi-arid landscapes, that with more vegetation, with higher amount of biomass and root biomass on the landscape, there seems to be a steeper slopes and more converging topographies. And a similar pattern is also observed from the same elevation, but across aspects. Seems to be polar facing slopes with different type of vegetation, maybe more vegetated polar facing slopes have steeper gradients than the equatorial facing slopes. Another study, this one is from the Golan Heights, that shows that northern aspects have steeper gradients and they also have more vegetation. Another emerging property of this at the latitudinal scale, at the global scale perhaps, is the observation that these patterns are pervasive. It pervades in the steeper polar and record, this paper published by Polis et al. Shows that northern facing slopes, polar facing slopes is always steeper between the 40 north and 40 south latitudes than the equatorial facing slopes. So this is an emergent property. And another emergent property are at the pattern, at the smaller scale, at the pattern scale, that's the pattern vegetation. These includes bandy woody plants, gap patterns, labyrinthine patterns, and spot patterns. But the very interesting observation in the literature is that the models that are developed to study these patterns are very different than the ecohydrology models and the dynamic vegetation models. Ecologists have used dynamical system models, including reactive advection diffusion models, going all the way back to Turing's initial work, kernel-based models, and hybrid models that includes some of the two. And what they found is that a simple principle relating growth to lateral water transport explains the variety of self-organized patterns. So it just seems like the water is the key thing in all of these patterns as well. And the secondary influence was the plant facilitation and plant-mediated changes in soil and nutrients have that secondary role in these in forming of these types of patterns. So then, looking at the landscape evolution at the various scales, then how do we deal with model complexity? So I'm going to divide this to a Venn diagram, and I have landscape evolution models, ecosystems models, and hydrology models. And then we look at the way these models have progressed over time and get more complicated. The initial set of models have been more disciplinary. The landscape evolution models largely look at the geological time processes, and there was not hydrology in them. And similarly, the ecosystems models, the first set of vegetation pattern models, they have used the advection, diffusion, and reaction rules, but there was no hydrology in them. Biogeography models, they looked at temperature thresholds and so on. And the hydrology models, they were interested in essentially predicting the hydrograph, right, and maybe getting some of the saturation patterns. And over time, models have developed, became more interdisciplinary, and became more complex in all of these different disciplines. And then more recently, you start seeing models popping up in these intersection areas. And what I call this the intersection of the middle between the landscape evolution models, ecosystem models, and the hydrology models is sort of an optimal or maybe an ideal model complexity. And by what I mean by that is that these models should be sufficiently capture characteristic space and time dynamics of each coupled state variable and the fluxes that are exchanged by them. Perhaps a model like LandLab or a toolkit like LandLab could have the potential to develop models like this, because then we can update each state variable based on their characteristic time scales. I'd like to give a couple of examples of this from a child landscape evolution model in studying the influence of the influence of biomass, influence of shear stress in a coupled ecohydrology and geomorphology model. this study was conducted in a sort of a similar type of climate like New Mexico. And the idea is that there's an ecohydrology model that represents the characteristic soil moisture and evapotranspiration dynamics. And there's a geomorphology model that relates the biomass to the shear stress and then does the geomorphic model. The model was tested at the soil moisture time scale. I get to test it at, based on observations. There's an example of soil moisture, evapotranspiration, leaf air index calculations model, and annual runoff and sort of the runoff and return period relationship that have been sort of backed by observations. And then the model is used for long-term simulations to study the influence of aspect and solar radiation. When we take this model and run it across latitudes, remember that one outcome I talked about was the role of the latitudinal variation of the hill slope asymmetry. And when you model, when you run this model across different latitudes, we observe this behavior. North-facing slopes or the polar-facing slopes get steeper than the south-facing slopes. And this pattern, running this model across the latitudes, with given different precipitation rates, we can see that this pattern sort of pervasive across the 40-degree north and 40-degree south. And within this different precipitation regime, still the observation holds. And another interesting outcome is, what surprises do we get from a coupled model? Now, we use this model in order to predict, look at the sensitivity to an abrupt climate change. And I'm going to talk about an experiment about that, run by Arvind Singh et al. In San Antonio Falls Laboratory. And they have an experimental mountain set up. There's an uplift provided to this, and there's a rainfall simulator. And they've studied, they looked at the change in climate. What you're seeing is their observations in a slope, average slope angle and average erosion rate domain, okay? At steady state, starting from an initial climate with a certain slope and steady state erosion rate on the domain, an increase in precipitation leads to a rapid increase in erosion because there's more water, and there is loss of slopes. The landscape becomes flatter. And then as the wetter climate continues, then there's a transient period, erosion rates decline, and the slopes decline. And then at that point, they change the behavior to a dry climate, and the cycle goes back to where it started. And what they see is a counterclockwise response in the slope and erosion domain to wet and dry climate cycles. Now, if we take our landscape evolution model and do a similar experiment like this, disregarding vegetation, assuming that the landscape is bare or maybe very little vegetation in it, we have the same response. The same sort of pattern emerges in the system. But when we put the dynamic vegetation on the system with its ecohydrological variability and so on, we get a totally different type of behavior. The behavior becomes more complex. And one interesting observation is that during the wet period, there's deposition in the system because of the vegetation growth. Lush vegetation grows and it has an influence of the flow shear stress partitioning and the sediment deposits from hill slopes into the channels. And the slopes decline. When the climate changes to the drier, then the vegetation dies, and there's increase in erosion. Initially, slopes increase, and then slopes get back to as the landscape goes back to the steady state, and the slopes decline and erosion declines. And a very interesting behavior emerges. In the model, it's just because of the vegetation dynamics and its cyclic behavior. Another observation in this is that where if you take all these points as independent data and it fit a line through this with the dynamic vegetation, this sort of resembles the mean erosion rate, mean basin slope relationship that have been widely published based on looking at the long-term erosion rate and mean slope data. So a couple of notes here is that dynamic vegetation in the model that governs the transient landscape response is key to sort of getting these cycles in the response of erosion and slope. It reverses the geomorphic response to climate change compared to the bear case or insignificant vegetation cover case. And it lowers the variability of the spatial mean erosion and slope over time. So the landscape actually becomes more stable. And one last note on surprises is that there's the question of savanna stability. And one big question in ecosystems is that are savannas stable over the long term, maintained by disturbances? This is a land lab application using in a semi-arid climate. It has a storm generated in it. There's solar radiation, soil moisture, vegetation dynamics, and cellular automaton. Spatial competition has been used between plants. Plants seeded with certain fractions, and the model runs. In the model, there are fires, and there's a linkage between the fire. The fires are generated by lightnings, and if the lightning sees a grass on the landscape, it has a higher chance of burning it. If it sees a trees on the landscape, it has a smaller chance of burning it. There are, the thousands of years, this landscape behaved like a grass-dominated savanna. But at some point, some gradual increase in the tree cover led to sort of a critical canopy structure, and that sort of interacted with the fire model, because when there's lightning, it was seeing more trees and grasses, and all of a sudden there's a catastrophic shift from a stable looking grassland savanna system to a more tree dominated savanna system. So that's sort of another example of like a surprises in a coupled model. But the important aspect of this is that if we have landscape evolution models running underneath it, and I think the patterns will be very interesting to see in terms of its geomorphic outcomes. So we discussed sort of three fundamental questions. We proposed that the model should sufficiently capture characteristic space and space and time dynamics of each coupled state variable and fluxes. And we've presented several examples. And with that, I'd like to thank the Watershed Dynamics Group and the Land Lab. Thank you.
Thank you, Erkan. We are starting to get short on time. I'm not at the perfect gatekeeper, and I also wanted to give people the chance to talk to our speakers a little bit, even if it's through the chat. So we'll take two questions, and I'm hoping you're going to stick around for Muriel's talk in a little bit of like an overtime, and so that she will have her time too. So are there any questions for Erkan? I see like a lot of positive comments that they liked your like connection between like the vegetation and like how landscape evolution processes coming. I don't see any pressing questions yet. Oh, here's one from Greg. Can you elaborate on what was behind the sudden shift in vegetation type?
So the sudden shift in vegetation type is just the connection between the fire frequency and the landscape, existing vegetation type on the landscape. The little changes in tree cover that leads to that sort of separates the fire cycle, because the trees are less susceptible to fire than grasses. And therefore, as the trees attain sort of a certain threshold of cover, then it reduces the fire probability. And the fire probability leads to more spread of trees through the cellular automata process. And then there's a further reduction in fire return period, and that leads to sort of a complete shift from a grassland landscape to a forested landscape.
Mm-hmm. Now the questions are starting to fill in like really quickly, Erkan. You'll have like a little bit of a chat job after we move over. Maybe we'll take Zeli's question. What geomorphic processes and properties do you think are relevant to prediction of decadal scale vegetation and carbon cycle?
Oh, that's a very good question. I mean, I think it would depend from site to site, and it will depend how large your watershed area is and so on. And I think like rapid erosion and deposition would be one thing to look at.